Hello and welcome to Conversations with Dr. Stephen Greer. This is Dr. Greer, and I'm the director of the Disclosure Project and the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence. And I'd like to thank the folks at the World Pooja Network for hosting us here every 2 weeks to bring you updates and perspectives on the projects we're working on. And I have with me today Dr. Ted Loader, who's our science advisor and is on the board of CSETI and the Disclosure Project. And he's going to be discussing with me the prospects for new energy breakthroughs in the 2012 and the path forward into a new and sustainable future on this planet. So thank you for joining us, Dr. Loader.
Well, you're sure welcome, and Happy New Year to our listeners.
Yes, indeed. Happy New Year. Well, so here we are in 2012, and we're approximately 105 to 110 years into an era when we could have had free energy, energy from the quantum vacuum, and been off of fossil fuels and ended poverty on this planet. So what we're going to be talking about today is the state of the world as it is and what we've got to do to get into the future that's awaiting us. And when I say it's awaiting us, it's because it's actually already here. It's just that it's been stolen from us. And one of the things that I've thought of actually putting together, and when I, in my spare time sometime, I'm going to write a book called The Lost Century, because really there's an entire century of lost technology, science, social and spiritual evolution that we need to recover. And I think this is a shocking concept for a lot of people. A lot of people think that when they hear about the sort of things that, that Dr. Loader and I talk about, it sounds very futuristic, it's sort of like the Jetsons or something. But in reality, we're talking about technologies that already exist that have been classified or suppressed or bought up. And at times, people have been murdered to keep these things quiet. I've suffered a great deal of these sort of interventions, up to and including, but not quite yet, being murdered. But I will say that, unfortunately, there are people who have been. And as Dr. Bearden, who has written the definitive textbook on this, called Energy from the Vacuum, it's nearly a 1,000-page book, you know, he outlines in the interviews he's done with Disclosure Project that there are people who have been dealt with in that manner. And the question always becomes, you know, well, who is behind that, and why don't we have these sciences? And it's basically exactly what Eisenhower warned everyone about, and that's that there is a very well-organized military-industrial complex, the operative word here, complex. So when people say, well, it's the government doing it, you know, that's really not true. You have to define the government. Which government? A shadow government, a parallel government, a secret government. And, you know, as the Senator Inouye said during the Iran-Contra event, he said, you know, there exists a secret government, is what he called it, with its own Air Force, its own Navy, its own funding mechanism that's above the law and free from the law itself. And a lot of people didn't quite know what he was talking about. And this was, of course, in the Iran-Contra hearings, which were, gee, I don't know how long ago, 30, 40 years ago now, I guess. 30, certainly. So what we are dealing with now at this point in history is the prospect of bringing out here in this pivotal year, 2012, sciences and technology, as well as the information that we can bring our civilization into the 20th century, since we're now more than a decade into the 21st century. And the reason I say that is that geniuses like Nikola Tesla, T. Townsend Brown, and others were doing work with very high-voltage systems that resulted in pulling energy out of basically the fabric of space-time around us. And some would call this trans-dimensional systems, or hyperdimensional, or interdimensional systems. Those are all pretty interchangeable words, really. But when you start looking at trans-dimensional systems, what you're really talking about is that there are energy fields, and as they're seeing now with the quote-unquote discovery of black energy and black matter, or dark energy and dark matter is what they're calling it, that most of the known universe is something which heretofore hasn't been accounted for in terms of the energy of it. And what is that energy, and how do you access it? Well, these are things that empirically, meaning hands-on, people began to stumble upon and discover back in the late 1800s and early 1900s. And the scandal in all this, of course, is that the oil cartels and the big financial interests and others have worked very hard to suppress these breakthroughs, ridicule them, marginalize them, and keep them from widespread application, and that this is really something that needs to change. And it's not just a technological issue. It's really a moral issue, an ethical issue, that we not allow the world to be destroyed and that we not allow so much human suffering and poverty to continue when the solutions for many of these huge problems have been invented by geniuses that have existed already on Earth, and who, through the mind of this creative aspect of the spark of consciousness, have come upon these discoveries. It's not something that has to be given to us from extraterrestrial civilizations. It's something that's universal in terms of universal principles in physics and science. But it isn't as simple as just the science. It's also a huge social and spiritual crisis that we continue to have these sort of breakthroughs kept secret, and that we as a people have not yet organized ourselves to bring them forward and stand up to these bullies and to these fascistic proclivities that some humans continue to evince as we stand here in the early days of 2012. And that we have got to find a way to bring out these wondrous sciences that would give us a completely new civilization without pollution and without poverty. So that's really what where we have to go. And Dr. Loder, I'd like for you to comment on sort of your experience in this field and what you see on the horizon or things that you're beginning to hear about that you're investigating.
Oh, my gosh. You know, it's sitting back and looking at this whole business. I've been involved in this for, 14 years or more now. And I must admit, during the late 90s and early 2000s, when we started learning about, I started learning about all this and working with this and working with you and others, you know, it was obvious that this technology should come out any day. And every year about this time, I said, well, this is going to be the year that it's going to be the breakthrough. And here we are in 2012, that magical year, according to some people, still waiting for the breakthrough to occur. And I just talked to one of my colleagues in this business who also is looking for energy technologies. In fact, I spoke with him earlier today, and his comment to me, this is the year it's going to happen. Of course, he and I talked last year, and he said the same thing. So it's a bit discouraging from that point of view. So having said that, I do have a couple comments about some of the technologies that are making noise right now.
Right.
Been making noise for the last 6 months or so. One thing that has happened in the last year or so is that the, quote, the cold fusion crowd, or the low energy nuclear reactions, LENR, people have
right.
gotten a lot of publicity, and there's a chap in Italy by the name of Rossi, Andrea Rossi, who has a number of claims relative to producing tremendous amounts of heat through a energy conversion using special catalyst nickel, the copper transformations, etc. And he's taken a lot of heat for this. I might add, if you start to read about this sort of thing, he's taken a lot of heat from a lot of really high-end physicists who have been working in the cold fusion for a number of years because his physics explanation, if you will, doesn't compute or doesn't make sense. So that the jury's out still on that, in spite of claims to the contrary. And one of the problems that he has, or his team has, and that's the ECAT. It's also known as the ECAT device, cold fusion. One of the problems that he has is that he makes a certain amount of claims. He was going to sell units, 5 or 10 kW, 10 to 20 kW, that sort of general range, units for 5 or 6,000, and he claimed he had order for thousands of these. And suddenly, in a recent interview, he just claimed that he was going to be making 10 to 20 kW units for Home Depot, selling for $1,000 to $1,500, and they plan to be producing a million units by this fall. Well, most of us who sort of observe this field feel that that's probably a pretty far reach. And we don't see how you can take a hot water generator, which is what cold fusion is doing, and produce that kind of kilowatts of energy, excess energy, and price it at $1,000, $1,500. The cost of making heat into electricity, just the materials cost to be able to do that technology.
Well, yeah, and for this whole discussion, I mean, without getting into the weeds on something that's perhaps bogus, which I think is a waste of our time, frankly, is the sort of reason why the OrionProject.org has said, look, if somebody has a technology, we have a leadership team that can bring it out, but it's going to have to go through the vetting process. It can't be these sort of assertions without taking it to people who we've identified, who are educated on this area of science, who are at universities, who are engineers, who are physicists, and have it independently reproduced and transparently tested and brought out. What we've found as we've gone around the world, and this is one of these things that, on the one hand, it's quite clear these technologies exist and have been developed and have been confiscated or seized or bought out. On the other hand, a lot of the stuff you hear about on the Internet, and this is something listeners need to know, when you drill down on it, it's sort of a mirage in the desert. And we have got to be very, very clear that there is a scientific method and there is a scientific process that has to be adhered to. And if the person isn't willing to be rather transparent in allowing the technology to be investigated, tested, proven, but also independently reproduced. The sine qua non of science is independent reproduction and verification of any experiment, whether it's in biochemistry or genetics or physics or anything else. And so this is really, really critical, and this is the standard that we insist on. Now, ironically, what you find is that the people that we've met who actually have developed or had these sort of things have gotten national security orders or threats and have shut down their efforts. Many of the people who make claims, and particularly the loudest ones, end up not to have anything at all. We're waiting, you know, it's sort of trust but verify is where we are. The other way of doing this, instead of waiting for someone to pop up on the radar screen, is for the research and development community who are concerned with the environment and energy independence and a sustainable future to take part of the literally hundreds of billions of dollars that are going into a solar and wind and the ARPA-E program at the Department of Energy and et cetera and so on and so forth, and take some small amount of that, say, you know, $10 million, something like that, so that a lab could be set up where the people who we've identified who are legitimate engineers, physicists, scientists, electrical and mechanical engineers could come together and actually reproduce this effect and come out with at least an initial generation one device that is a very clean operating device. Unfortunately, no one has ever wanted to do that because there seems to be no basic science research in this area. The research that we know is going on and has gone on, it's all been classified, unfortunately, in the military-industrial complex. And the few people that we know who have developed these things independently have been visited by folks with national security orders who have basically seized these devices, and not just in the United States, but in other countries as well. One of the things that I think is very important for people to remember, about a year and 3 months ago in the fall of 2010, the Federation of American Scientists came out with a report, and Stephen Aftergood was the author of it. And it's on our website at the OrionProject.org, where it talks about the over 5,100 patents that have been seized under the national security provisions. And in this report, he talks about how in 1971, because they couldn't get information on many of the things that had been seized, but going back 41 years now to 1971, he spoke about a solar photovoltaic generator. And that's a generator that, you know, takes the sun energy, turns it into electricity, is what photovoltaics are, that was 20% or more efficient. Now, this is 40 years ago. I have a photovoltaic farm at my house in the country, and ain't nowhere near 20% efficient, I'll guarantee you that, the solar panels you can buy now. So this was 40 years ago, and that this was seized under a national security order when, obviously, there were no threats. This wasn't nuclear weaponry. This wasn't a particle beam weapon. This was something that, at that point, because of the high efficiency of the photovoltaic cells being more than 20% efficient, would have been a competition in terms of price point to coal and gas and oil. And that's why it was seized. And in this report, it says it's hard to see how this would be something to benefit the national security. In fact, our national security is obviously harmed by our being so dependent on oil from the Mideast and the Persian Gulf states, and where our whole economy is held hostage, and where we spend $1 trillion a year on a war machine having a presence over in that part of the world. So not only is it not in the interest of the national security of the United States and its people, it actually harms our national security that we are so dependent on fossil fuels and on coal, because the coal, even if it's domestic, is doing enormous damage to the environment to both mine it and to burn it. So the question becomes, who really is making this kind of a decision? Well, it isn't the President of the United States, and I can guarantee you no member of Congress or anyone in the White House knew of the seizure of this very efficient photovoltaic system that was seized, according to the Federation of American Scientists, a very mainstream scientific group, 40 years ago. 40 years ago. So you look at that and you go, my God, what would happen to someone who came up with a free energy generator that's pulling energy out of the fabric of space-time? Well, they'd come after that person like a pack of rabid Rottweilers. And that's what's happened. There's a man that, Ted, you know who I'm referring to. I don't want to wish his name publicly, who back in the 1970s, after studying with one of the most brilliant scientists in this area at the University of Washington, who had worked with the Montauk Project and other top secret projects, had started a company dealing with transdimensional physics and had developed such a device. And in came the jackbooted thugs. They had an all-access pass. They had a national security order. And they seized his technology and said, look, this technology is going into a vault, and you're working for us now. And almost 40 years later, this man is still working in an underground SCIF, a secure communication intelligence facility, working for the part of the secret government through a contractor. And when he tried to come forward in 2010, less than 2 years ago, to deliver to us one of these free energy devices that would pull energy out of the atmospheric electromagnetic high voltage systems, he was visited by a former CIA director who had been working with Booz Allen Hamilton, and was threatened, and his wife was threatened, and he basically said, I can't do this for you. So this is something, this is not, I want everyone to hear this. This is not a conspiracy theory. So put aside the bogus things that you may hear about on the internet. These are real things. And in fact, Dr. Loader, you visited the facility that was storing the Stan Meyer equipment, which another group that had more money than we did got. We don't have it. A lot of people think we somehow got the Stan Meyer equipment. We did not get it. Another group that no one's ever heard from since got it. But before that collection was sold to this other group, you went out there with our team and saw a toroidal, a donut-shaped electromagnetic generator that was a free energy device that had had a national security order on it for decades.
That's correct. In fact, there were many, there are a number of variations of that same theme that Stan Meyer had developed.
Right.
And he was basically told, you will not develop this any further, in spite of the fact that he had reports on it, test reports and everything else.
Well, it's because he had it. And he said, in other words, what I have found is that once any of these systems become operational, because the national security state is so wired into everyone's business, no one's going to be able to keep it a secret. I don't care if you're in the Amazon jungle. And here they come. Murder Incorporated shows up and does this. This is something that should be investigated by the people who are supposed to be looking out of our interest. Instead of them worrying about trivial nonsense, like whether someone's doing something that doesn't hurt anyone else. I hate to sound libertarian, but I don't really care if someone, you know, wants to smoke a joint. I do care if somebody is killing people who are inventing technologies that could save the world. And, you know, I think people are getting fed up with this nonsense, quite frankly. And what's happened is that people like Stan Meyer, who most people associated with the water car, the car that was running on water, which it was, but they don't know he had this other stuff. And the reason they don't know is that he was under a national security gag order. And, in fact, Ted, you met with the man who knew of that personally, who went to this storage facility with you.
In fact, it was interesting because this is a gentleman that I met and worked with a little bit at that time, who said he had worked with Stan Meyer and Stan's mayor and his brother as well.
Right.
And he told me that, you know, the water technology was really very interesting and definitely worked. But the really interesting stuff was this toroidal generator technology that Stan had developed. And he told me first rate, because he knew firsthand that that had been sequestered or refused to allow to go forward at all. So,
and so, you know, a lot of these technologies, what people don't realize is that that's the case. And the one I cited earlier that had worked with William S. Bender at the University of Washington, who had this transdimensional physics company back in the 1970s, those are all systems that had not even gone to the point where they had a patent on it, because, in other words, the 5,100 and some patents that have been seized, many of them illegally through the patent review process, that 5,100 number does not include devices that have been confiscated or seized prior to the patenting process, which are the ones we're talking about. So that's probably another several thousand devices. And this is something where, you know, I really think that at some point we're going, if these breakthroughs can't be allowed out, we need to find somebody who is an expert on whistleblower lawsuits, where we get a group of people together, put this testimony together, and absolutely sue these aspects of the government and corporations that have been doing this. Because at a certain point, if they keep chopping off the heads of these sort of innocent and brilliant inventors, and the people are then left to get a 10 or 15% efficient solar panel, and, you know, you have to spend $100,000 for a system that would run a decent-sized house. I mean, this is just insane. And unfortunately, you know, that to make that dynamic change, we're going to have to find the people who are going to have the courage to stand up to these people, because they really are quite frankly, I don't like to use this word, but they are very fascistic in their outlook and in their behavior. It is a very worrisome thing in a world that is supposed to be a democracy, where we're, you know, we are supposed to be the land of the free and the brave and all that, when in reality, our entire civilization is being run over roughshod by these corrupt interests that have infiltrated our agencies, our courts, our political system, and our large transnational corporations. And this is not a conspiracy theory. This is a conspiracy, but it's a fact, not a theory. And I think that this is why people have got to understand that, you know, bringing these technologies out is a very difficult process, because when the people who really do have something begin to emerge, they're usually shut down and threatened. And the people who don't have anything that you hear a lot of noise about, and quite frankly, many of them have been, we've found to just be fraudulent, those are the ones you hear about. And so this dynamic is, to say the least, very dysfunctional and frustrating, and yet we know it's possible, and therefore the stakes are so high, it's something that you cannot ignore. It's something you cannot look the other way. And if you do, it's an immoral act to look the other way when, you know, when people like Dr. Loader and myself have actually seen this sort of evidence and technology and looked into it, and then you see a world where you have so much environmental degradation and poverty and suffering and needless mayhem and death and wars over a paradigm that has to do with our energy generation systems, which quite frankly are, you know, anywhere from nearly 70 to 150 years old. One of the things I point out to people is that coal-fired power plants and the burning of coal goes back centuries. A nuclear power plant, which nuclear atomic energy, where you split the atom to get heat, and that heat is then used to boil water in a steam turbine, that's from the 40s, okay? There's no, and jet engines are from the 30s. Rockets are from the 40s. Well, what in the world has developed from the 40s to now? Nothing. This is ludicrous. Yeah. You know that's not true. You know, and yet people don't think of it this way. They don't think of the fact that there's, you know, the better part of a century of technologies missing. Well, this missing lost century is what we need to reclaim, we the people. And we need to say, all right, it's time for a new civilization. And it isn't going to happen through Ouija boards and wishful thinking. It's going to have to be some serious work and people coming together who are vowing to make this change happen. You know, one of the things that many people have asked me is they said, well, how much would you need to put a laboratory together so that some of the most brilliant scientific minds that you found all over the world who understand these principles could work together? I said, well, anywhere from around 6 to 10 million, depending on how long the project was and the objectives, but in that range to do the initial phase and develop these technologies, because we have so much information already on what Stan Meyer developed and on what these other scientists who we've met with, and some of them are in classified projects, have shared with us. And people said, well, that's not very much. I said, no, it's not very much money. The dog pound down the road here from me that the shelter has was a $6 million project just to build it for stray dogs. Now, I love stray dogs. All my dogs have been adopted as stray dogs. In fact, I just adopted a new one this week because we had a stray dog come up here to the farm, and so we've taken him in. But the point is that certainly saving the world's environment and getting these new energy systems out are worth what a dog pound cost. And yet, the government will not provide grants for this, and no private foundation or individual has. And this is what's rather shocking, actually, is that, you know, this subject has been marginalized and is off the radar scope so far that here we are without the means to do what should be a very minor research and development project. And so we need to find a way of doing that, and so we're still working and looking into how that can happen.
One of the things that we need, a lot of people send us information about what various people are doing, and one of the pitfalls that a lot of, shall we say, amateurs or people who aren't along the trail far enough in terms of developing things, is that they, A, do not know how to measure what they're doing, and so one of the, or what their output or what their input of a particular device is. And one of the things that we at the Orion Project basically require somebody is that if you are going to do this and make various claims, the best way to prove a claim is to what we call loop the system. In other words,
close the loop.
Provide energy from the device. The energy goes back into the device, whatever the device is, to drive the device, if you will, or provide energy for it to run. And it produces excess energy that then can be siphoned off, if you want to put it in those terms, or use to charge batteries, which in turn can light lights, run power, provide power for other jobs without. So that's closing the loop. And a lot of people don't seem to be understand this, and yet, if you close the loop and the device sits on the countertop, not plugged into the into the main system, into the wall, if you will, what have you, it's very easy to demonstrate and scientifically measure what's going on, because you can measure, and particularly once the device runs for hours to days or longer without running down batteries or anything else, then you've really proven that you've reached the goal of producing something that can be useful in the real world. And that's really a criteria. That a device that produces a few milliwatts and lights a tiny little light bulb is not really useful for most of us in our houses. People's houses use anywhere between 2 and 10 kilowatt hours a day, depending on how they're using electricity, whether it's heat or just lights or whatever. And so you need some real power to do things in this world.
Yes, and of course, you know, if it's a small prototype that can be scaled up, that's certainly acceptable. What isn't acceptable is if somebody that makes a claim and then that cannot be vetted and tested or reproduced. Now, one of the reasons I keep referring to this, the need for reproduction, is that we have gotten to know some scientists who really aren't that well trained they're sort of hobbyists, I should say, rather than scientists, and they're not that well trained in the scientific method, and they do a lot of things, and they don't know quite what they did to get the circuit to do what it was doing. And so if you cannot document that, and you cannot then put it into a schematic and into a design that someone else can reproduce, then frankly, it's not a science, because you may not know what you did that got that result. And I'm not going to mention any names here, but you know, Dr. Loader knows some of the folks I'm talking about. And so there has to be the ability for a group to independently, even if it's done confidentially, reproduce it, because if it cannot be reproduced, it isn't a real science yet, and it isn't something that could benefit 7 billion people. Ultimately, our goal is not so much prove that this is possible. We know this is possible, and if you go to the orionproject.org, you'll see many, many papers and historical overviews that have established that these sort of systems have existed. Our concern is more, how do you bring these things out to the public on a large enough scale to benefit humanity and the Earth? And to do that, you're talking about a complete retooling of our energy infrastructure for 7 billion people. We're talking electric grid would be gone. Motor vehicles would have electric engines that stay continually charged. Every home and business would have its own power plant. But this is an enormous paradigm change. And, of course, that's one of the problems. I remember the year before Obama got elected, I met with a man in Washington at the University Club there, not far from the White House, and he was the man who was an advisor to President Bush, W. Bush, on the nuclear industry and nuclear, as he said, energy. And we were having this dinner, and you know, at this place, and it was interesting because it's one of these places where you know you go in there and you see Donald Rumsfeld there, you see all these people. And this man turned to me, he says, "Yes, well, the technologies you're talking about are too good." I said, "What do you mean?" And he didn't mean too good to be true. He says, they're what we call disruptive technologies because they would upset the apple cart too much. I said, "Sir, with all due respect, what could be more disruptive than a $1 trillion war in the Middle East, a collapse in economy, and a biosphere that is on the verge of collapse, and 7 billion people who are going to start fighting over, you know, resources that are being depleted like oil and gas and coal." I said, that is as disruptive as it can be. I would call these technologies transformative technologies. But you see, the difference is from where you're sitting. If you're sitting as someone who, Westinghouse or GE, who makes giant nuclear power plants, or people who own coal companies or oil companies, or people who have centralized utilities in their 401k or their pension plans, and their stock owners and shareholders, and the people who make billions of dollars trading commodities at Goldman Sachs and other commodities trading organizations who trade the futures of what they call future contracts on coal and oil and gas and other commodities, uranium. This kind of information ain't great news for you, because you're going to go the way of the horse and buggy, all right, or the typewriter. I mean, nobody uses an old Royal typewriter anymore like my mom used to use. So I think that, however, if we cling to that old paradigm, we're going to go down with the ship. And so what we're saying is that before we do any more damage to this beautiful and sacred planet, why don't we wisely bring these technologies out for peaceful purposes and create a new civilization? Yes, it would be a new macroeconomic order, but we need one. The current one is collapsing under its own corrupt weight. It's obvious to everyone who looks at it. So that's what we're proposing. Now, obviously, there are people who would like to hear and see this happen, and that's the majority of humans on this planet. But then there are people who really don't want to see this happen because it's not in their own selfish interest. But we really have to begin what our interests are. It's sort of a redefinition of what that is. And I think this is, at the beginning of the year here with our New Year's resolutions, I think we all need to say, what are we doing? What is our purpose? And we can't just weigh our purpose based on what is in our own selfish best interest, because if we do, that's a prescription for catastrophe. And, it was like some years ago when I had to think about, well, I'm going to leave the practice of medicine. And, if I had remained chairman of emergency medicine at the hospital where I was, I could be making now, I would be making $400,000 or $500,000 a year as a senior person on that medical staff. Instead, I'm making, frankly, less than 10 or 20% of that a year. And it has been very, very difficult, and it's been a lot of sacrifice. However, it's been worth it, because it's doing something that you know is purposeful for the world. And I think that's the metric, the new metric that has to begin to be discussed, the new morality that needs to be discussed. Our media is so obsessed with the sexual and titillating scandals that come and go, whereas I don't, that was the stuff of sort of comedy plays in the Middle Ages. The real moral issues are, do you sit by and let the world perish and let people starve or be in terrible poverty when there's a solution to be brought forward? Do you choose these sort of selfish power interests over something that would benefit the whole of humanity and the earth? This, to me, is the morality we need to be talking about, not what kind of foolishness people do with their nether parts. Now, I hate to be so blunt, but I just think that there needs to be an honest discourse on what the moral compass is that we need to set and how we get there, an ethical and moral society where we don't measure everything by, how much wealth and power an individual or a corporation can amass. That cannot be the only metric. And if it is the only metric, then that is not a good thing for society, and it's not a good thing for the earth, and it's not a good thing for the future of humanity. So this is where we need a lot of people to think about this, and people of goodwill, men and women who understand these issues and come together, and to make clear and clear a pathway into the future, because I know that this eventually will be the science and technology that will be coming out. These trans-dimensional, hyper-dimensional, whatever you want to call them, sciences and physics will be the sciences that come out. And then after that, what will be really the big breakthroughs will be the sciences involving consciousness and thought and the interface where all of that comes together, which, of course, is what we use in our contact protocols at CSETI.org, CSETI.org. And so I think that, we have to put all of these elements together. We have to disclose the information. We have to bring the technologies forward. We have to make peaceful contact with our interplanetary and interstellar neighbors. And we have to pull this all together in a forward movement, which is why We're all working on this, and we need folks' help. What we're looking forward to in this year is a new level of disclosure and a new level, a higher level of contact. And we hope that we will be able to put the elements together to begin to bring out these new sciences and technologies so that the world can function where it should have been within the last 50 to 100 years had there not been the intervening effect of this kind of corruption and greed that has suppressed all of these sciences and technologies.
At the risk of this being the beginning of the year, you're absolutely right, Steve, on what you've been saying there about what has to happen. My sense of things is that things will happen in steps, of course. The giant step is too big for the media and the corporations who control the step. And so things are going to be allowed to sort of progress at a slow level. So at the risk of being a predictor, if you will, or a quasi-predictor of the future, always dangerous, the long-term future is we either develop these technologies and move away from the unsustainable planet direction we're on, or there will no longer be a society on this planet such as we're used to. That's simple. How to get there is the issue. But let me make a couple predictions here. I'm going to predict that 2012 may be the, in terms of energy technologies, the year of heating water. There are several different technologies that people are working on. We mentioned the Rossi work, but there are other people that are working on cold fusion type technologies that heat water that probably have a lot better claims to fruition than he does at this point. The Storen company in Ireland has some technology that they're producing and claiming a COP, a coefficient of performance, of 40. In other words, they're producing 40 times more heat energy than the electrical energy that goes into their HEFA heat technology, using a very clever known physics, no magic. But it points out or it makes available to the knowledge of people that if these things are possible. There's some other countries around the planet, some in Africa, who are developing some heating technologies using electrical circuits.
Right.
So suddenly, hopefully, somebody within this mixture is going to come up with some technologies that will produce heat. And our society uses a tremendous amount of heat. Everybody in this country who has a standard home heats water somehow, whether solar, electrical, coal, or oil, or gas, to do normal household technologies as well as heat the house in the colder climate. So that is one type of technology, and that may be one of these transitional technologies that will sort of make people aware that there's an alternate way to do things than the way they've been doing than up to the present. That's good. Very good. There's another, there are other several technologies or several groups working on solid state technologies. One group is presently working on the Floyd Sweet technology that Dr. Bearden talks about extensively in one of his books. Floyd Sweet developed a magnetic resonance system that, using specially conditioned magnets, produced electricity under a certain electrical field, far greater amounts of electricity than went into the system. There's a group working on that presently who is claiming thousands of watts output for very little wattage in. Stay tuned on that one. Don't know, I haven't personally seen it yet, but I hope to sometime within the next year or so. There's another group, EEFG, who has developed solid-state generators. Several years to develop, but these are totally solid-state, using a very proprietary mixture of various elements and various combinations, produce basically a permanent battery, high voltage, low current, but they can be added. That group is working diligently on trying to develop that. There's people in those technologies, by the way. Dr. Rear met people working on that type of technology over about 20 years ago.
Right.
Developing solid state technology, and that fellow who was working on that was basically told to stop in fact, forced to stop in a very nasty way. And yet, so other groups are starting to take up that flag, if you will, and try to move that forward in different countries in the U.S., I might add.
One of the things people listening need to understand is that any breakthrough like this that happens, well, it's like the tree that falls in the woods and no one hears about. That breakthrough has got to be not only disclosed, but disseminated quickly, because time is your enemy. If something like this develops and these fascistic forces, what I call Murder Incorporated, gets a hold of that person, that team, or that technology, it's gone. And this is not theoretical. This has happened over and over and over again for 100 years. And so I think that one of the reasons why we're talking about this here early in 2012 is that we are in a world emergency. Whether this is actually the end of the Mayan calendar or not, we are at a point where we are going to be closing out this old paradigm and this old civilization and starting a new civilization that will go forward in prosperity and in peace and in interstellar contact for 500,000 years of unbroken peace, continual peace. But you cannot do that with the macroeconomic social injustice system we have today that requires the majority of the world's population living in poverty. Let's think about this for a moment. If the 7 billion people on Earth live like we do here in the West, or as the aspiring people in China and India would like to live, we would be out of fossil fuels very quickly, long before we would end up destroying the entire atmosphere and melting both polar ice caps in a cataclysmic geophysical catastrophe. And that's why bringing these technologies out is one of the most pressing concerns. But the technology in and of itself is only about 10% of the problem. All the money on Earth is maybe 10% of the problem. 80% of it is a strategic plan that discloses and gets this out in front of the masses and in front of the key scientific people and in front of the public, who will demand that it not be suppressed. I've always thought that, and this is one thing that I, if there are any scientists listening who are working on this, listen very carefully. Secrecy is your enemy. You think you're protecting your intellectual property by keeping it quiet. You're not. You're actually giving the advantage to the people who, at the right time, when you get your breakthrough perfected, are going to swoop in and confiscate it or shut it down.
Absolutely.
Or shut you down.
Absolutely.
And so everyone needs to understand that the public, and with the internet and social media and Facebook and Twitter and all that, this sort of information, if it can be verified, so you have to have the system working, then you have to verify it, test it, and reproduce it. But then at that instant, even before you talk about manufacturing, you go to a massive disclosure of the information. Now, how do I know that? Because 10 years ago, we collected over 100 top-secret military and corporate and intelligence witnesses to the UFO subject, put them together very carefully, had an event at the National Press Club, which you can see online at disclosureproject.org, and disclosed that information in something that at the time was the most watched event in history at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., and was the most watched news event in the history of the Internet at the time. We can do the same thing with these technologies, but it cannot happen before there's independent verification and independent reproducibility of the system. But it has to happen quickly. We are set up to do it. This is why we have the Disclosure Project, also why we have the OrionProject.org, is so that when this moment happens, and we will be counting on you, everyone listening, to be part of that, if you will, sort of a global Tahrir Square, a sort of a global springtime, where everyone will announce to everyone else that we are now liberated from the slavery of the macroeconomic system and oil that's destroying this planet. And we will need everyone to be ambassadors of peace and activists in this regard. But we have to get to that initial point first, where there's a science or a technology that's operational, not theoretical, but operational, that we can then launch. But that's what we're setting up and have been setting up for a number of years. And we think that that's really important, because if most scientists and most inventors and even investment groups think, well, if we build a better mousetrap, the world will beat a path to our door, no problem. What they're leaving out of that are the special security, national security, international security, macroeconomic implications of such a breakthrough. And with that comes all of this pressure and all of these, quite frankly, illegal activities, where we can have a photovoltaic generator from 40 years ago seized illegally by our patent office and kept secret, when all of us could have been having free solar power for the last 40 years. This is outrageous, and it isn't going to change until we, the people, say it's time for a change.
Absolutely. And it is interesting that you've mentioned the disclosure project several times here in our discussion, and it's interesting that one of the major reasons why the ET subject, or the extraterrestrial subject, has not been disclosed by the powers that be, is that it would immediately validate some of these technologies.
Right, and of course that was explained to me about 20 years ago, before I briefed the CIA director, Clinton's CIA director, on this. I started drilling down on this. I said, well, isn't this a great thing? Why isn't it all known? And someone said, look, you cannot disclose that the UFOs are real and that the extraterrestrial visitations are real without the scientists saying, how are they getting here? When that is asked and then people come forward with the answers, it's the end of oil. It's the end of gas. It's the end of the petrodollar. It's the end of public utilities. It's the end of the internal combustion engine. It's the end of jet engines, rockets, nuclear power plants, all of it gone. Think about it.
That's
a great thing for the planet, but, you know, that's a multi-trillion dollar statement I just made. And for that, a lot of things have been done to maintain the status quo. And, you know, the other thing that was interesting about this meeting with Bush's advisor on nuclear power and energy that I had before Bush left office is he said, you know, no matter whether someone's left or right or moderate or libertarian or whatever, when they get into the Oval Office, they all govern conservatively. He didn't mean from a political point of view, but from the sense of the word of not wanting to change, because something like this rocks the boat more than the change that they want to manage will be. In other words, it's just too much change. I remember years ago our military advisor had a meeting with an admiral who was in charge of CONUS, Continental United States Security, and they were talking about this, and the admiral said, yes, you're absolutely right, this does exist. The problem is, I don't want to manage that change. It's too big of a change, and no one else does either. I just want to get out of this command and go fishing at my ranch in Wyoming or wherever it was and be done with it. So, unfortunately, it does take a lot of courage to want to take on a change this big, but this is the big transformative change that has to happen: disclosure, open contact, and new energy for a new world. That's what we're all about. So, and that's what this year has to really exponentially increase the potentiation for.
And hopefully the 2012, as we said, predicting the year is difficult, but maybe hopefully this is what the changes will be this year. And by the way, we aren't the only group speaking of this and talking about this. I read a blog just today by George Urie, who is a commentator on the economics and whatever else.
Right.
Commentating or commenting on what he calls the WebBots project, where they search the web for future trends, saying that they expect things, major happenings to occur in the early March period, the first week of March. And he's suggesting that maybe, not necessarily, but maybe, that's when the secrets are revealed about the ETs being here, cast in stone. He makes a comment, the existence of ETs becoming cast in stone would automatically validate half of what's considered fringe science today.
Right.
And people will suddenly start making major discoveries in the power area, you and I know that it won't be making discoveries. It will be rediscovering discoveries that.
Right. It's really the great unveiling. It's really the unveiling of what is known already. And that's what's really the good news to people who often get so despondent over the state of the world. I say, look, yes, things are in a very great state of flux and dysfunction, frankly, but the good news is the sciences, the technology, the information, even the consciousness and spiritual knowledge that's been coming forward through the World Puja Network and the Vedas, all of that exists on Earth today. It's all here. All the seeds are ready to sprout and are sprouting for an entirely new civilization on Earth that will become an interstellar civilization. And that's what's exciting, and that's what people need to realize. It doesn't happen by itself, and the ETs aren't going to land on the White House long and make it happen. We, the people and the children of Earth, have the primary responsibility of that. Our friends from other star systems stand ready to assist, but we've got to be the prime movers, and that's what we invite everyone to do. On that note, those people who are interested in going out under the stars and making contact with us and learning how to be an ambassador to the universe, we're going to be on the Gulf of Mexico at Marco Island in April. And if you go to cseti.org, you can see more about that. We're going to have an expedition out there on the beach, a small group, probably around 20 to 25 people. And so if you think you can take time off, you're invited to join us for that. I think that people who have come on this have found that it's an amazing and transformative and life-changing experience, because it's a week of not only learning meditation techniques and remote viewing techniques, but also learning how to make contact and how that contact proceeds on many different levels, conscious, thought, electromagnetically, electronically, physically, and personally. So this is all something that we'll be training people and joining together in a contact expedition under the stars. And if you'd like to join us, it'll be in April on the beautiful beaches of Marco Island on the Gulf of Mexico. I think we're out of time, and I'd like to thank Dr. Ted Loader for joining us today. And Happy New Year, Ted.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank the folks at the World Puja Network for hosting us here every 2 weeks. Next time, I'll have a special guest, Colin Andrews, who invented the term crop circles. He and I will be discussing the crop circles of 2011 and what he sees for 2012 and beyond. So please join us for that special event next time on this show, Conversations with Dr. Stephen Greer. Thank you all, and God bless.